Hello friends, today I will be discussing with you the fundamentals of dairy chemistry. Now in this we will be discussing in two parts. In first part I will just discuss the composition of milk, its constituent and the nutritional importance and the physicochemical properties of milk. In the second part I will be discussing the thermal processing of milk and the preservatives, neutralizers and adulterants and their detection. So what is milk? First thing comes, before discussing the chemistry of milk, the first thing comes, what is milk? Now milk is a mammary secretion produced for the newborn of any species. It is a complex biological fluid containing different constituent in three different phases. The milk proteins and a part of milk salt is present as colloidal dispersion. The milk fat and fat soluble vitamins are present in oil and water type emulsion. And the lactose, water soluble vitamins and a part of or a portion of salt constituent is present in serum or in true solution. Now second thing, as far as composition is concerned, I will be giving you the composition of four species: the cow, the buffalo, the goat and the human milk. Now why these three I have chosen? Because the milk of three species, cow, buffalo and goat, is generally processed in our milk plants. And why the processing is there? It is for the fluid milk supply or for manufacturing of different product which are for human consumption. And why we consume the milk or milk product? Because of their nutritional value. So just to compare how these milk vis-a-vis the human milk, they differ or whatever is the similarity, and how they nutritionally, how they are important to us compared to human milk. So as far as composition is concerned, the major portion of milk is constituted by water, which is from 83% or 84% to as high as 87% or 88% in different milk. Now then comes the total solids. Total solid comprises the fat and the non-fat substances, which is known as SNF. Then proteins are there, lactose is there, which is a milk carbohydrate, and then S, which is the total of all the milk salt. So these are the major constituent of milk. As far as these constituents are concerned, cow milk contain about 87% of water, about 13% the total solids, about 8.8% is solid not fat and 4% is fat. Then proteins are 3.4% to 3.5%. Lactose is about 4.7% to 4.8%, and S content is about 0.7%. In case of buffalo milk, the water content is less, which is about 83% or 84%, and the total solids are higher, which may range from 16% to 17%, or sometime may go to 18% or even higher. Then SNF content is also higher, 9.7. Fat content is very high, which may range from 6% to 7%, or sometime it may go as high as 18% or 20% in case of certain breeds of buffaloes. The protein content is also higher, about 3.8% or 4%, it ranges. And the lactose content is almost same, 4.8% to 5%. Then S content is higher compared to cow milk, about 0.8%. It shows that minerals are present in higher concentration in buffalo milk. Then goat milk is almost same. Only exception is that the mineral content is higher even compared to buffalo milk, which is the S content, which shows by the higher S, which is about 0.9%. Then as far as human milk is concerned, the human milk, two, three things are very specific to human milk. One is that the protein content is very low. It is just in the slide, it is just reverse. In case of goat milk, you just read human milk. The protein content is very low as 1% only, and the lactose content is very high. It is as high as 6.8% or 7%, and the S content is very low, which is about 0.2%. Then, factor affecting composition of milk. The milk, if we take it from cow or buffalo or goat, from any species of the animal, it is not always same. From compositional point of view, it is not always same. There is a variation in the composition, or you can say the different constituent varies. And the factors which influence the composition, they are individuality of the animal. That means different animals, even from the same species, say if you take the milk of cow, and in cow, if same breed is there, the different milk will have difference in composition of milk. That is because of the genetical makeup of the individual animal. So the genetical factor influence, or genetics of the animal influence the composition. Some animals has higher fat content, higher protein, higher lactose compared to others. Then second is the species of the animal. As we have already discussed, that milk from different species differ with respect to its constituent. Say for example, if we take cow milk and buffalo milk, the fat content is higher in buffalo milk, the S content is higher. But if we take human milk, the S content is very low and protein content is very low. On the other hand, the lactose content is very high. Then from the same species, if we take, say for example, cow milk, different breeds produces milk which differ in composition. So breed of the animal influence the composition. Milk from different breed has different composition. Then age of the animal also influence the composition. Young animals have milk which is higher in total solids, fat, protein, etc. compared to old animals. Then stage of lactation means when the cow or buffalo, they give birth to the to their newborns. The milk which we get is known as colostrum, and it is very rich in proteins, total solids. Particularly the whey proteins are very high in colostrum. Then as the lactation proceed, there is a decline in the concentration of protein. There is an increase in fat, then lactose, then certain salt constituents are also increased. Then again there is a difference in the composition as the lactation ends. So in late lactation milk, again there is a decrease in different constituent. The next factor is the feed of the animal. Feed of the animal, which we feed to the animal, also influence the composition. Say for example, if cotton seed or binola or the cotton seed cake is given to the animal, then the milk which we get is higher in fat percentage. Similarly, other constituent of milk are also influenced by the feed which we give to animal. Certain constant remain almost constant. Say for example, the lactose almost remain constant. It is not influenced very much by the feed of the animal. Similarly, calcium, if we take the example, is not very much influenced by the feed of the animal. If the feed of the animal is rich in calcium, then the excess amount of calcium is deposited in the skeleton of the or in the bones of the animal. If, on the other hand, the milk is deficit in calcium, then the calcium from the bones or the skeletons comes and goes into the milk. But in milk, the concentration remains almost same, except there is a variation in salt constituent. When there is a infection of udder, say when the animal is suffering from mastitis, then the salt constituent are affected very much. Say, for example, there is a decrease in the chloride content, but there is a increase in the chloride content, but corresponding decrease is there in sodium. Lactose content is also higher. It is just to maintain the osmotic pressure of the milk. Osmotic pressure of milk is almost same as that of the blood. So to maintain the osmotic pressure, if some constant are decreased in the milk, the other constant are increased. So there is a influence of mastitis. So the infection of the udder influence the composition, then other diseases. Suppose the milk is the animal is suffering from TB, the composition of milk will be affected, it will be altered. Then milking efficiency. The foremilk which we get in the beginning of the milking, that is known as foremilk, that is different from the milk which we get at the end of the milking. So if the animal is not very effectively or completely milked, then we will get difference in the composition. Then fermentation of milk or pH of milk or acidity is developed. If acidity is developed, that will also influence the composition. How it will influence? Due to fermentation of milk, the lactose get converted into lactic acid. So there is a decrease in the lactose, which depend, the extent of the decrease depend on the extent of fermentation. Also, there is a decrease in the citrate content of milk as a result of fermentation. It is because of the fact that microorganisms which ferment the milk, they consume the citrate. Therefore, there is a decrease in the citrate content of milk. So these are some of the factors, or these are the major factors which influence the composition of milk. Then next we go to the milk constituent. The milk constituent, water constitute a major portion, as I have told you. Then there is a fat, protein, lactose, salt constituent, vitamins and enzymes. These are the major constituent of milk. Then some minor constituent are also present. Then first we will take milk proteins. Milk proteins which are present in milk can be divided into two categories, the caseins of milk and the whey proteins. Now this division or distinction is based on the fact that when the milk is acidified or when there is a fermentation of milk, natural fermentation, so natural souring of milk is there, then the protein which get precipitated is known as casein. Its isoelectric point is 4.6. So when the pH of milk is decreased to 4.6, the protein which get precipitated from the milk is known as casein. Casein is not a homogeneous protein. It is a heterogeneous protein which contain different fractions. And these fractions are alpha S1 casein, which is the major protein, casein, alpha S2 casein. Then there is a beta casein and there is a kappa casein. So casein is not a homogeneous, but is a heterogeneous protein, and it contain different fractions. Then these fractions have differ with respect to each other in different animals, depending on the genetical factors. And these difference is known as genetic polymorphism. So in each case, alpha S1 casein has genetic polymers, alpha S2 casein has genetic polymers, beta casein has genetic polymers, and kappa casein also has genetic polymers. Now, whey proteins, those proteins which remain in serum even when the pH of milk is decreased to 4.6, or when there is a souring of milk, or when there is a acidification of milk, casein get precipitated, but whey proteins, they remain in serum. So you cannot say that they are soluble in water, they are not soluble, but because they are present as individual molecules, so they do not get precipitated until and unless the milk is heated before coagulation, before acidification. So the proteins which remain in whey or serum when the milk is acidified, they are known as whey proteins. Whey proteins are also heterogeneous. They contain lactoglobulin, which is the major component of the whey proteins, and about 0.6 or 0.7% of the total protein is constituted by the beta lactoglobulin. Then the second largest protein which is present in the whey fraction is the alpha lactalbumin, and then third one is the serum albumin, and then there are immunoglobulins, which are the protective proteins of milk. They protect us if we consume milk. Milk not only gives us nutrient but also protect us against diseases, and the immunoglobulins, they protect us against diseases. Then there is a protease peptone fraction of the whey protein. This is nothing but the breakdown product of other proteins. And there is a lactoferrin. This is known as red protein of milk or the iron binding protein, because it binds iron. Two atoms of iron are bound by one molecules of the lactoferrin. Lactoferrin is also a protective protein. It protects us against infection. Then casein, we'll discuss something, some properties of the casein. Casein is the major protein of milk. It about 80% of the milk proteins are caseins, and only 20% are made up of whey proteins. It is present in milk as calcium caseinate phosphate micelle, or you can say as colloidal calcium caseinate phosphate, because the casein is present in the form of the micelles in the colloidal dispersion. It is the different fractions of the casein, they get together, they get associated together with the help of phosphorus. Phosphorus form linkages, and the different fractions of casein get associated, forming sub-micelles or subunits of the micelle. In these micelles, the kappa casein, which is a the carbohydrate containing protein or casein, is present on the surface, and then calcium also get adsorbed on the surface of these micelles, and the total micelle is known as colloidal calcium phosphate, because calcium is there, phosphate is there, and casein is there. So different micelles with the help of phosphorus, they join together and form the micelles. And then calcium, some of the calcium is present inside the casein micelle, because it is present on the surface of the subunits of the casein, and some of the calcium get adsorbed on the surface. It is known as colloidal calcium. So the casein is colloidal calcium phosphate, and it is present in the colloidal form. In cow milk, not whole of the casein in cow milk is present in the micelle form, but about 5 to 10% is serum casein, which is present in the serum. But when we heat the milk, the serum casein also get precipitated, and it get adsorbed on the surface of the casein micelle. So in heated milk, if you boil the milk, whole of the casein get precipitated, and it is present, whole of the casein get change into or precipitate into micelle. In buffalo milk, whole of the casein is in the micelle form, even if it is not heated. When buffalo milk is drawn from the udder of the animal, whole of the casein is present in the micellar form. There is no serum casein in buffalo milk. This is a very major difference. Then calcium is absorbed on the micelle. Casein gets precipitated due to decrease in pH, addition of salt, and heating or freezing of milk. What happens when the pH is decreased? The casein, which is, I have told you, present in the colloidal dispersion and in the form of micelle, it is a charged particle. These micelles are charged. They have charge on them, which depend on the pH of milk. If the pH is higher than the isoelectric point of casein, which is 4.6, then the casein will have net negative charge. If pH of milk is lower than the isoelectric point of the casein, the casein will have a positive charge. So in normal milk, at the normal pH, which is about 6.6 in cow milk and about 6.7 or 6.8 in case of buffalo milk, the casein has a net negative charge. And this charge, negative charge, gives stability to the casein micelle to remain in colloidal dispersion, because the like charged particles, they repel each other. So because of the charge which is on the casein, and also because of the hydration, casein is hydrated, it absorbs water. So because of the absorption of water, the casein is hydrated. And because of these two things, the charge which is present on the surface of the casein micelle, and also because of the hydration, the casein is stable or remain in colloidal dispersion. But when the pH is decreased, the milk approaches the isoelectric point of casein, which is at pH 4.6, casein gets precipitated. Similarly, when the salts are added, they precipitate the casein. Heating also, when milk is heated, there is a decrease in the pH of milk, and because of that, the casein charge, net negative charge, is reduced and it gets precipitated. Similarly, when there is a freezing of milk, water gets converted into ice, and as a result, the less water is available to dissolve the casein. As a result of less available water, the milk salt which are present in the serum phase, they get precipitated and they get associated with the casein. Or you can say there is a shift in milk salt from the soluble to the colloidal state. And as a result of this, particularly with the adsorption of calcium and magnesium on the surface of the casein micelle, the charge is decreased. Similarly, when these calcium and magnesium get adsorbed, the hydration of the casein micelle is decreased and it gets precipitated. Then size of the micelle is between 30 to 300 millimicron in diameter. So micelles are not same or similar in size. Some micelles are very small and the others are very big, and the range is from 30 to 300 millimicron. The smaller micelles are more stable compared to the bigger micelles because of the larger surface available, and because of the larger surface, the kappa casein, which is a glycoprotein, is more on the surface of the smaller micelles, which gives stability to them. Then micelles are bigger in buffalo milk compared to cow milk. Paneer, channa, cheese, etc., which are the coagulated product, you can say either coagulated by the acid, milk is coagulated by acid, or with the addition of rennet, they are produced due to precipitation of casein. Casein get precipitate and we get paneer, channa or cheese. Then fermented product, milk product, say for example dahi, yogurt, lassi, srikhand, are also the result of precipitation of casein, and as a result of precipitation of casein, milk get coagulate and we get dahi, lassi, srikhand, etc. Then isoelectric point of casein, as I have told you, is 4.6. Then second class of the proteins, which is known as whey proteins, they as I have told you, remain in serum when the casein gets precipitated due to decrease in pH. They are superior nutritionally than casein. Whey proteins are much more superior nutritionally compared to whey protein, and the superiority is because of the presence of higher concentration of essential amino acids. Essential amino acids are those amino acids which are required by the human body, but they cannot be synthesized in the body. Particularly the tryptophan, sulfur containing amino acids, which are 2, cysteine and cysteine, the whey proteins are very rich in these three amino acids. Although it is rich in other essential amino acids also, but particularly in these three, whey proteins are very rich. And because of that, they are much more superior nutritionally. Then lactoglobulin is the major whey proteins in milk. As I have told you, it constitute about 0.6 to 0.7%. Its molecular weight is 36,000 Daltons, and its isoelectric point is about 5.2 pH, or exactly 5.18. Then the lactoalbumin is the second protein present in higher concentration. Its concentration is about 0.17% or so. It is involved in the synthesis of lactose as a coenzyme. Its molecular weight is 16,000 Dalton and isoelectric point is 4.2. Then serum albumin is the third important protein of milk. Its molecular weight is 65,000 Daltons and the isoelectric point is pH 4.72. Then immunoglobulins are the protective proteins, as I have already told you. Also the lactoferrin, which has molecular weight of 80,000 Daltons and isoelectric point of 8.2, is also a protective protein. Its molecular protease peptone are the breakdown product of other proteins, as I have told you. Then the milk lipids. Milk fat is present in the form of globules. In milk, the fat is present in the form of globules. Now, these globules are 3 micron in average, 3 micron in size. In buffalo milk, these are bigger. These globules are surrounded by a membrane which is known as fat globule membrane, and the membrane, like casein micelles, is also charged. At normal pH of milk, it has net negative charge, so the globules are stabilized because of the presence of this negative charge, net negative charge. If milk is acidified, as in the case of formation of dahi, or sometimes we just, you can say, cream is there, and the aging of cream is there, so we add some, you can say, culture to the cream, and as a result of this, when there is a decrease in pH, the separation of milk fat from the milk becomes easier, separation of cream or butter or whatever it is, because the charge, net negative charge on the fat globule is decreased. On storage, these globules get separated and form a layer or cream at the surface of the milk. In spite of the fact that globules are stable because of the presence of net negative charge, but they differ in density. Their specific gravity is much lower than the specific gravity of rest of the milk constituent, and as a result, because of the gravitational force, if milk is stored for sufficient period of time, the fat globules are raised to the surface and they form a cream layer or cream at the surface of milk. Fat gives palatability to milk product. Because of the typical flavor of the milk fat and also the taste, it gives palatability, and also it gives richness to the product, or you can say the product becomes soft in texture, and also in when we consume the product, its taste is better, aroma is better, so it gives palatability. Milk fat is rich in calories. Energy, which is provided by the milk constituent, the fat, protein and lactose, they provide energy to us. But the energy provided by the fat is more than the energy provided by the lactose and protein together, because they provide about 4 kilocalories per gram, the energy, whereas the fat, it provides 9 kilocalories per gram. Then, components of milk lipids. Why we call them milk lipids? Because it is not the fat only. There are other components. The true fat is made up of triglycerides, in which the fatty acid, different fatty acids, we have about 20 fatty acids in milk, different fatty acids. Some of them are saturated, lower chain fatty acid, while others are saturated but higher chain fatty acid. Some others are, the example saturated lower chain fatty acids are the butyric acid, linoleic acid, caprylic acid, the butyric acid, the caprylic acid, the capric acid, the caproic acid. These are the lower chain saturated fatty acid. Then we have higher chain fatty acid. Say for example, the stearic acid is saturated fatty acid, but its chain length is higher. It is higher on chain fatty acid. Then we have the unsaturated fatty acids, which may be monounsaturated, means there is a double bond is present. There may be one double bond, when one double bond is there, then we call it a monounsaturated fatty acid. When two, more than one double bonds are there, we call it polyunsaturated fatty acid. So we have three types of fatty acid in milk: the saturated fatty acid, the monounsaturated fatty acid, and the polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now, then we have diglyceride. Some of the triglyceride form when the fatty acid they combine with glycerols. So we can say that triglycerides are the combination product of between glycerol and the fatty acids. Then we have some diglycerides whose concentration is very low, 1.25 to about 1.5%. Major proportion or major portion of the milk fat is made up of triglycerides, which are 95 to 96%. Then we have monoglycerides, free fatty acids, phospholipids, which are present in very low amount. Then we have sterol, particularly the cholesterol, which is accused for, just milk fat is accused for cholesterol because it creates problem in the heart disease or cardiovascular disease are there as a result of higher consumption of cholesterol. Then we have squalene, and then we have fat soluble vitamins, but they are present in lower concentration. Then there are milk carbohydrate. The lactose is the major carbohydrate which is present in sufficient amount. Other carbohydrates are present in the form of oligosaccharides. They are important, but lactose is very important. It is the major carbohydrate of milk. Its concentration is about 4.8%. Its concentration is higher in human milk, which may be as high as 7%. Lactose is disaccharide of glucose and galactose. Due to the presence of free aldehyde group, it is a reducing sugar. It reduces the Fehling solution, and this property is utilized in the estimation of lactose in milk, because when we titrate a known volume of phthalic acid, say 10 ml, then how much we take a standard solution of lactose, and we titrate with the standard solution of lactose, the Fehling solution, and we don't note down the reading, how much lactose solution is required to neutralize a known volume of Fehling solution, and then we take unknown or the milk serum and we titrate, and by that we calculate how much lactose is present in milk. On fermentation, lactose forms lactic acid, which is the reason why we get the fermented product. Lactose is converted into lactic acid and milk get coagulated, and we get dahi, lassi or yogurt, srikhand, etc. Then lactic acid is responsible for making dahi, lassi, srikhand and yogurt, the fermented product. On heating, it reacts with casein to produce brown color in milk, which is known as Maillard browning. Particularly the glucose moiety of lactose get reacted or it get interacted with the amino group of the lysine, which is present in milk. So there is an interaction between the glucose moiety of the lactose and the lysine, which is amino acid present in protein, and there is a development of brown color in milk, which is known as browning of milk. Then its crystals are gritty. When we consume the lactose, if it is in the form of crystals, we get a sensation of sandiness in our mouth, because the lactose do not get dissolved very quickly, and therefore the ice cream lead to a sandiness in ice cream and condensed milk if its concentration is higher, and it crystallizes in the form of very bigger crystal. Some people are intolerant to lactose. They get allergy. They are intolerant to lactose because the lactase, which is the enzyme present in the body of human body, is lacking in their body, and as a result they cannot hydrolyze the lactose. So they are intolerant to lactose. The next component is the milk salt. Milk salt can be divided into two categories, the major salt constituent and the trace element. Major salts, the distribution or the classification is not based on the importance of salt constituent in milk, but it is based on their concentration. The salt constituent which are present in higher concentration are known as major salt constituent, and the trace element are those constituent which are present in lower concentration. The major salt constituent, we have calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, phosphate, citrate and chloride. Now out of these, calcium and magnesium are the divalent cations, sodium, potassium are monovalent cations, phosphorus and citrate, they are the polyvalent anions, and chloride is the monovalent anion. Now except other than these, all the other elements which are present in milk are grouped under trace element. Now concentration and partitioning of milk salt. What is this partitioning? As I have told you in the beginning, that casein, proteins, milk proteins, and a part of or a portion of salt is present in the colloidal form, and a part is present in the dissolved state or in the serum phase. So salt, they get partitioned or they get distributed between the dissolved and the colloidal phase. Some portion is present in the dissolved state and some portion is in the colloidal state or is present in association with the milk proteins. Now as far as the concentration, we have taken three milk, cow milk, buffalo milk and human milk. Total concentration or milligram per 100 ml of milk or per 100 gram of milk, calcium in cow milk is about 123 or 125, you can say, milligram per 100 ml. Then out of this, 33% is in the dissolved state, which is present in the milk serum. In the dissolved state also, there are again two categories, the ionic calcium, which is present in as calcium ions. There is no association with any other mineral, and also there is an inorganic salt form. The calcium is also present in association with phosphate and citrate as calcium phosphate or calcium citrate. So there are two categories in the dissolved state, the ionic calcium and the inorganic salt form of the calcium. So 33% of both ionic and inorganic salt form is present in the serum phase, and rest 67% is associated with the milk protein. Either it is present inside the, again there are two categories in the colloidal phase, either these elements are present inside the casein micelle or they are adsorbed on the surface of the casein micelle as colloidal particles. In case of magnesium, the concentration is about 12 milligram and 75% is in the dissolved state. Then sodium, 50 milligram per 100 ml, 95% or almost all the sodium is in the dissolved state. Similar is the case with potassium, concentration is 150 milligram per 100 ml or almost all is present in the dissolved state. Phosphorus is about 120 milligram per 100 ml and 40% is in the dissolved state, whereas the 60% is associated with the milk protein. Citrate concentration is about 175 milligram per 100 ml, and whole of the citrate is present, almost 90% is present in the serum phase. Very little is associated with the milk protein. Chloride concentration is about 100 milligram per 100 ml, and whole of the chloride is present in the serum phase. It is not associated with any other mineral, or it is not associated with the milk proteins. Then as far as cow and buffalo milk are concerned, buffalo milk is very rich in calcium and magnesium. 180 milligram is the calcium compared to only 120 or 125 milligram in cow milk. Also magnesium 20 milligram compared to 12 milligram. Then the monovalent cations, the divalent cations are higher in buffalo milk. Then monovalent cations are lower, the sodium and potassium in buffalo milk compared to cow milk. The polyvalent anions are almost present in the same concentration, 120, 175. Chloride is less in buffalo milk. So buffalo milk differ from cow milk with respect to concentration of different minerals. Then in soluble form also, the 20% only of the calcium and 55% of the magnesium are in the dissolved state compared to 33 and 75% in cow milk. But if we take total concentration out of 180, 20%, so it comes to same 33% or 40 milligram in cow milk and 40 milligram in buffalo milk. Then in case of human milk, the minerals are very low, as we have seen that S content is only 0.2% compared to 0.7 in case of cow milk or 0.8 in case of buffalo milk. So mineral total concentration is less. Calcium is 40 milligram compared to 120 in case of cow milk, 180 or 200 in case of buffalo milk. Magnesium is 5 milligram compared to 12 or 20 milligram. The sodium is 15 milligram, potassium is 55 milligram, the phosphate is 14 milligram, and citrate is 20 to 80 milligram, chloride is 30 or 33 milligram. So as a whole, the minerals are less in human milk. Then also in case of human milk, most of the minerals, calcium, magnesium, phosphate, etc., they are present in the serum phase. They are not associated with the milk protein, because in case of cow, human milk, the casein is present as individual component and is not in micellar form. Very little is in the micellar form, and the micellar are very small compared to cow or buffalo milk. Then the milk salt are important. The milk salt are very important from processing point of view and also from nutritional point of view. As you know that calcium and phosphorus, they are involved in the formation of bones and teeth. The processing also, these milk salt are important because they give stability to the casein micelle. Then texture of acid and rennet coagulated product, means the dahi, yogurt, Srikhand, also the rennet coagulated product means cheese, and also the paneer, channa, etc. is influenced by the salt constituent. Then heat stability of milk and concentrated milk are also controlled by the salt constituent or influenced by the salt constituent. Age gelation of condensed milk, in condensed milk, is also influenced by the salt constituent. Then the stability of proteins and fat and texture of the frozen product, say for example, if we take the example of ice cream, the stability of proteins, fat, is influenced by the or controlled by the salt constituent. The texture is also controlled by the salt constituent of the ice cream. Then the milk enzymes, about 30 enzymes are present in milk. Out of these, the most important are peroxide, which decomposes H2O2 into water and oxygen, and it is important in the you can say stability of milk or shelf life of milk. Okay.